2 weeks ago, I published a video on Ethernet connections and other digital connections. Where the video should offer only answers, it generated more questions. So time for a Q&A. The basic concept of what I explained in the video was that due to pollution and distortion of the analog signal that is used to carry the digital information, the clock input of the digital to analog converter is fed with a signal that causes small timing errors, resulting in jitter. This jitter will lead to several kinds of distortion of the analog outputs of the converter. For instance, losing bottom, sibilance becoming harsh, the stereo image getting shallow, focus being reduced, voices and brass instruments sounding nasal or sharp, and so on. There, aberrations can easily be heard, and if there is someone wanting to finance a professional scientific double-blind test, I'm quite willing to set it up. But provided you have access to a proper stereo, you can check it for yourself. Compare a cheap digital source to a high-end one over a proper DAC, amp and speakers. If you don't hear a difference, there's no need to further watch this video. And now comes the scary thing for some people. These aberrations are not measurable in the analog domain, so after the digital to analog conversion. If the bass goes less deep with one player compared to another player, the frequency response of that first player still is ruler flat to 20 Hz or lower. Regardless whether you measure it with a gliding tone or FFT. This has to do with how our hearing interprets sound. That puzzles people that want proof of what they are hearing. Time for the first question. I'm missing more about how much it affects the analog signal out of the DAC, since most DACs of today have so high resistance to jitter. More jitter into a DAC doesn't necessarily mean degraded sound quality out of the DAC. In an ideal world, that would be true. But if you ever come across an ideal world, please let me know. Only the best of the best DACs, like the Grim Audio I use in my setup 1, cope well. But it will set you back 18k. Check for yourself. Play the original release of Famous Blue Raincoat of Jennifer Worms and play the title track. If the sibilance on the voice sounds clean and natural, you're lucky. Another track to try this, the album Irk by Nitz, track 4 on CD 1, Sketches of Spain. Again, does the sibilance sound natural? My bet is it won't. After watching how vibrations affect clock oscillators, I put my DAC on isolation footers. I hope it makes a difference. Good footers make a difference, especially if the surface the DAC is placed on is prone to vibrations. The same goes for other digital equipment like streamers and CD players. Having said that, there are many footers that have little effect, like spikes, and always start with the rack or shelf the player is placed on. It is always easier to prevent vibrations than to filter them out. I like the research, but the bump to the box may be a moving probe as well. That is difficult to use as an argument right now. That's a fair point. Thanks for the input. Thank you so much for this information. Do you have any recommendations about Ethernet switches or the physical placement of DACs? About placement, I just made a comment about that. About Ethernet switches, see my playlist Audio Grade Network Switches, link in the top right corner at the end of this video and in the description. It is impossible to give personal advice to everyone. What switch is most suited for you depends on many factors, like the quality of your stereo, the budget, how you value money, and how you enjoy sound quality. A few years ago, I invested in a Rune Nucleus Plus, and now much of my music resides on a Nucleus. I downloaded new music to my computer and then copy it via that Ethernet connection to the Nucleus. Do the downloaded files suffer permanent damage as a result of having been transferred through the Ethernet switchbox and cable? Ethernet is extremely robust. All bits will be transferred from one device to the other. The same goes for the Internet. music files can be transported over thousands of miles without a bit missing. As I said in the beginning of this video, it is the pollution and distortion of the analog signal that is used to carry digital information. The clock input of the digital to analog converter is fed with a signal that is prone to small timing errors that lead to jitter. That pollution and distortion is ignored in the digital domain. Is Wi-Fi better or worse than Ethernet cable for audio streaming in this case? There is no absolute answer to this question. It depends on how well Wi-Fi is implemented, how good your access point is, how well your other equipment, like the amplifier, is protected against the aggressive Wi-Fi radio signal, and so on. Then there is also the matter of available Wi-Fi bandwidth. If you live in the countryside, with the next neighbor at a kilometer distance, you have the full spectrum of Wi-Fi frequencies at your disposal. But in an apartment building, with neighbors left, right, above and below you, the Wi-Fi signal to your streamer might be of poor quality. Since 5 GHz is less capable of penetrating through walls, that might be a better choice in areas with busy use of Wi-Fi. But you might need more repeaters. So the best way to find out, as often with audio, is just to listen. Should buffering not solve the jitter issue that you mention? If I disconnect my player from the network, it continues playing till the buffer is empty and then there is no cable influence anymore. If jitter on the incoming signal was the problem, buffering might help. But in contrast with what I believed in the past, this is not the case. And buffering as such could introduce additional jitter if the electronic design is not done extremely good. For instance, if the power rail feeding the buffer is not 100% stable and fast, a power burp the state change causes will temporarily lower the voltage and thus influence the threshold, which lead to timing errors. The same goes for flip-flops that are also used in digital equipment. This is quite common amongst mid-class DACs and streamers. So even if the incoming digital signal would be optimal, jitter on the DAC chip might occur due to circuit limitations. The problem with buffers is that they are prone to the same phenomenon as flip-flops and DAC chips. As soon as the digital signal is in the isochronous domain, jitter introduced there can only be repaired by high-quality components used in very clever circuits. All the effects I mentioned before have their influence. Please read Understanding How Perturbations on Digital Signals Can Affect the Sound Quality with Changing Bits and How These Issues Are Addressed by the Upturn Ether Region. You find the link in the description. I don't understand how a clocking crystal is related to a network switch. That part I didn't understand. It's not the clocking that is the culprit. It's the pollution and distortion of the clock signal close to the DAC chip. Any phase noise, DC shifts, fluctuating power lines and other mishap causes jitter on the clock input of the DAC chip. Clever filtering, a cleaner switch mode power supply to power the switch and a good shielding of digital connections all can make a difference. But then again, if inside the DAC the power supply isn't 100% stable, if cheap flip-flops are used, if the clock oscillators have poor specs, you still won't get optimal sound quality. The same goes for the streamer when digital out is used to a DAC or for a streamer that is used with the internal DAC. As an audiophile IT engineer, I hear and notice differences in sound when switching network gear and cabling. What I do not yet comprehend is where the time jitter happens. On the network, the data is sent in blocks of bytes and on every switch router in the path checked for correctness and asked for a resend in case of issues. This means that on the receiving end, the streamer, when converting this data block to a clocked stream of bits, the jitter is introduced, hence not on the network, where you rightfully state that the square waves are not really possible, but in the streaming device. You are absolutely right, the data stays intact, but as mentioned before, there are influences on the square wave signal that carries the ones and the zeros that can influence the threshold while distortions of the square waves can also introduce timing errors. For the usually I2S signal can suffer from the same phenomena I described in my video connecting your DAC number 2, how digital can go wrong. In there I described the phenomena with admittedly exaggerated graphics. Sony and Philips did a great job selling digital audio as perfect. You can even drill holes in a CD and it will still play music. Network specialists helped by stating that bits will stay bits. My earlier idea that switches sounded better because of the clock oscillator didn't help either. I hope that research by Jaap Veenstra of alphaaudio.net and others will bring more solid proof of Swensen's theory. He showed in the Ether region that his work clearly does improve the sound quality. Some other audio grade switches do have significant effect on the sound quality too. And also the network filters by Artfark and Network Acoustics do that and have completely different approach. Fact is that these effects are clearly audible and heard by audiophiles all over the world. And on that bombshell we come to the end of this video. There will be a new video next week, so subscribe to this channel or follow me on Patreon, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram and TikTok to stay informed on when new videos are out. Help me reach even more people by giving this video a thumbs up or link to this video on the social media. It is much appreciated. Many thanks to those viewers that support this channel financially. It keeps me independent and lets me improve the channel further. If that makes you feel like supporting my work too, the links are in the comments below this video on YouTube. I'm Hans Beekhuizen, thank you for watching and see you next week. And whatever you do, enjoy the music.